presence. Come on, do you feel it? Hallelujah. Let's sing it.
The presence of the Lord is here.
The presence of the Lord.
The presence of the Lord is here.
Feel it in the atmosphere.
The presence of the Lord.
Good morning, Acts family, and welcome to our virtual Sunday service. We're so grateful you've joined us to lift God's name today, and we thank you for the continued support. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube and follow us on social media at Acts Santa Monica to stay up to date on all things happening. And if you would like to give to our church, you could do so by going online to actsantamonica.org and by clicking on the donating tab. And you can also give by mail and send it in to P.O. Box 7217 in Santa Monica, California. We look forward to receiving your gifts. Now this week's verse is Isaiah 41:10, which says, I will uplift you and I will strengthen you and I will uphold you with my righteous hand. Friends, sometimes it is okay to ask God for strength. And doing this keeps us connected to our faith and keeps us from clinging on to any ungodly people or choices in our world. And remember, here at Acts, we love you, we're here for you, and want to pray for you. So send in any prayer requests through our social media pages or through our website. Now let's get our hearts ready for Pastor Joe's word with some praise.
I know who I am. God wrote it in his plan. My name is victory.
Well, today, friends, I want to move forward and talk a little bit about our physical self. Well, not really, but I want to use as a model our physical self. I want to talk about how you might grow your faith, because faith is nothing but a muscle, but it's a muscle that's developed over time. For instance, I've got a title today's message, Personal Training. And all of us have had a trainer of some kind at the gym, and maybe you still have a personal trainer. Well, why do you have a personal trainer? Well, what that trainer does is that trainer can focus on certain areas of our physical weakness and help us develop the strength in that area to be able to carry the rest of the body. And I think sometimes, as Christians, we need a kind of trainer in this area of developing our faith. Someone to remind us of what we used to do. Someone to remind us that we can't do all of that anymore. So here's a good and obvious question. When you have a personal trainer and then you stop, now you're moving on your own to develop yourself. But what happens when you don't put into practice the things the trainer has taught you? Sometimes muscle atrophy sets in. You're weaker in some areas than you used to be. You're not strong like you were in the past. So life changes. And as life changes, look at it in the vernacular of our faith. When we become weaker in our faith than we used to be, things change. We can have accidents. We can hurt ourselves. We can let our guard down, and someone else can hurt us, actually. So let's take a look at this from the Apostle Paul, who is writing this wonderful letter to his protege in the ministry, Timothy. So he writes to young Timothy, and in his second letter to Timothy, chapter 3, verses 14 through 17, Paul uses these words. He says, "But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work." So the portion of this text that I want to take and bring to the forefront for us has to do with what you've learned over your Christian life. And do you remember who taught it to you? Because these are the things where the trainer comes in at. If we remember what we've learned, if we hold fast to what we've learned, if we continue to do what the trainer has taught us, we will build the body stronger. And that's what God is looking for, Christians to be stronger. We're living in perilous times, and our faith can be so easily moved from one place to another. We can start following individuals instead of God. So easily we can be persuaded. If the muscle of faith hasn't been trained, and if we don't continue the training process. So what have you learned in your Christian life that you can take into the future that will make your life better and help you to lead others to a saving and growing knowledge of Jesus Christ? God has created you with a focus and a purpose. This focus is discipleship. The purpose is change your world one person at a time for Jesus Christ. So how do we manage to do this consistently and continue to do it? Well, Valerie Burton, this prolific writer, has written a couple of things. She challenges us with a couple of questions, as a matter of fact. She sets up the sermon for today. with two questions that we should ask ourselves. The first question, what is the biggest lesson God has offered me over the last year, over the last 12 months? What have I gotten from what God has been teaching me, these various lessons that He's led me to? When we take time to learn the lessons that our trials and our triumphs teach us, God is able to mold our character and use us in greater ways. When you ignore the lessons of life that God has taught you, you often find yourself repeating the same mistakes and enduring the same challenges time after time. The second question, by the way, that she asks is, what is my divine assignment at this stage of my life? We all get older. We move from one stage of life to the next. What is your assignment from God for today? That's a good question to ask oneself and to self-examine. Our purpose can transform over a lifetime, you see. In order to remain in sync with God's timing and purposes, we must seek His assignment in various sessions of our lives as we go through these various seasons of our lives. When we're young, we have one focus. When we're older, our purpose is different. So we ask ourselves those questions. Now, I noticed something in this text that Paul writes here. He says, continue. He uses that word, interestingly enough, and the apostle starts this whole paragraph about in his letter to Timothy with the acknowledgement that life can be difficult for every believer. We can all be challenged. But just as the personal trainer would say, continue doing this over and over again, it will add strength to our lives as we plow through life. And that's what Paul is advising Timothy. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 12 through 13, Paul writes, indeed, all who desire to live godly in life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. So already now we know that Paul is telling Timothy that because your desire is to live godly, challenges are going to come your way unexpectedly, but they're going to come. So he says here to while the evil people and imposters will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. Even while they're going through their difficulties, we're also going through ours. We're being challenged every day. We're being challenged to use that muscle of faith to believe that God is indeed going to come through. When difficulties arrive, whether they're in the church or in our personal lives, it is from the teaching of Scripture that we receive the wisdom for the task that is in front of us. And by its influence, our own spirit is energized and refreshed. So that would bring me to the question of how often do you read the Scriptures? How often do you reflect on what you have studied in the Scriptures? Or are you one of those that attend Bible study and say, oh, that was really good? Or you attend the preaching service and say, boy, he really told us today. But you're not doing anything with it. See, God is calling us to use the things that we have learned in the Scripture. And that's exactly what Paul is reminding Timothy of. I know where you come from. I know how you came to faith. I know what you have learned in the faith. And he's reminding him to continue to use that when difficulties arise. He says, you're going to need to be energized. You're going to need to be refreshed. And it's the Holy Scriptures that's going to do that. In 2 Timothy 14, the A part of the verse, he says, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed. He uses an interesting word here with the word continue. What he's saying is that, remember now, continue is a present tense verb, but it is in the imperative mood. So Paul is saying, remember the things that you've learned and continue in those things. He's not only commanding him to do that, but he's saying it's possible. And in difficult times, that's what we need to remember, that God has brought us through once before, and certainly he can bring us through again. So Paul is advising this young man. The apostle is telling his young disciple, be remaining, be stalwart, be abiding in the things that you have learned. So never say, I can't, or it's impossible. Go back to what you've learned in the Holy Scriptures. He says, when trying to balance your life between what is right and what is not right, always rely on what you have learned from the Word of God. That's what Paul is really saying. The Word of God says in Philippians 4 and 13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And boy, is that not true? But here also is the danger of marginal Christianity. People that just attend church service, people that just attend Bible study, people that don't internalize the Word of God and put into practice what they have learned from the Word of God. That's the marginal Christian. And I fear even for the new Christians, they face the same kind of challenge. They have not yet learned. So they are living out that fruitful experience of true Christianity, but they're not living it out as strongly as they can. They're not as committed to their faith as they can be. And sometimes, even though we get weak in the journey, we fall by the wayside. That's why Paul is using this term, continue. Continue in what you have learned. Continue in what you have believed. Yeah, in other words, I guess if we are slowing down in our walk, then at one point in time, that personal trainer had you building muscles up in your legs and strengthening your joints. But you've gotten away from that routine. And as a result of it, you are weaker now than you used to be. Well, the same thing happens in our faith when we step away from the challenges of living a godly life, we certainly get weaker. This is happening all over the world today. So never say that you can't do it or that it's impossible to do. When you see this word continue in 2 Timothy 3:14, it is the same word translated hold or remain in John 8 and 31, where Jesus is speaking to his disciples. And here's what he says. He says to the Jews who have believed in him, his disciples, he says, if you abide, that is to say, remain in my word, he says very clearly that you are truly my disciples. And continuing his thought in verse 32, he adds, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Friends, the only way to know the truth that will set you free in life is that you understand the Word of God. Continue in it, he says. Don't stop. Exercise that muscle every day. Every day. It will prove to be to your advantage. Jesus said to these people that you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Indeed, just as important as knowing the truth, one must know also who taught them that truth. Where did that truth come from? I don't mean, we know it came from the Word of God, but who taught you that truth? How accurate are they? How challenged have they been in their lives? What have you seen about these people? Because don't forget, Paul is talking to Timothy. And he's reminding Timothy, I know where your faith comes from. You know, what's interesting here is that I fear that we have allowed COVID to not only come and take over the world, but take over the church. And my greatest fear about that is it's moved us away from this being together all the time. I realize that some churches have come back together, and I realize that some will continue that way. But I fear that we're are allowing it to keep us from the personal training that we need in our faith. There are many opportunities. The Word of God is everywhere. You can't miss it no matter where you turn. But I'm saying don't move, don't use COVID as an excuse. Don't use anything as an excuse to back away from the Word of God. It's available on the internet and in virtual services. It's available in virtual Bible studies. The Word is available to us, so let's not set it aside. That would be walking away from what the personal trainer has been laboring with us. So I think it's important that, and more importantly, it's for our children and our grandchildren. You grew up in the Word of God. You grew up going to church 2-3 times on Sundays, in there on Wednesday nights for Bible study, went to choir rehearsal. You've been a part of Sunday school. You've been a part of church forever. But what about your children and grandchildren? What are we teaching them? Let's not abandon the Word. Let's not start them off with a weaker faith than we started out with, those that pushed us and planted that Word in us and kept nurturing us. Because the believer needs to be nurtured like muscles need to be nurtured. We need to be nurtured, friends. So I want to say that even in community, being in community with like-minded people, we're trusting the same God, is a huge help to the growth of our children and our grandchildren. It'll be a bigger help to them in their future. Because as Paul recalls to remembrance here with Timothy, you got that training, Timothy, from someplace in your past. So rely upon that training. Well, if we never get our children into some training program where their muscles can be built up in their faith in particular, then woe is it going to be to us later. Because they'll have nothing to rely upon, to lean back on. So it's important, and I'm really pushing that because I fear that we're going to allow something to happen. Now, with adults, the same story comes true, by the way. And COVID has introduced this to us. You know, much of our theology today is being challenged, whether you watch Fox News, MSNBC, or CNN, or wherever you get your news from. Every time you turn that television on, someone is talking about something that's theologically not accurate. So we have to reflect on our training. We have to remember that the politics of this day is very busy framing theology in a way that it's challenging to even the Christian person. Whether you have liberals or conservatives, doesn't matter. None are 100% correct all the time. Many of those that know more use what they know to twist that truth to convince you to join them in their pursuits of life. In the meantime, you become weak in your faith. You need to be personally convinced. Timothy was told by Paul in 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, he says, all scripture is breathed out by God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. Now, let me just put a pause there for a second. I'm going to take that to another level, but he says all scriptures breathe out. God spoke the scripture out. Yes, he spoke it into the minds and hearts of the men and women that may have wrote it down for us, but it was guarded by his Holy Spirit to be without error. And God puts great emphasis on that for us. You know, when he says here, for instance, all scripture is breathed by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, teaching tells us how we should be walking. Reproof says, hey, you just got off the pathway. You just stopped doing what you were trained to do. And then he says, correction tells us how to get back on the path. And then he ends that with, And it is for the purpose of training us in righteousness, which means that it teaches us how we should be going. So it tells us the way to go. It tells us when we get off the way. It tells us when we should and how we can get back in the way of truth. All scripture. So any place you open this book, there's help. That's what Paul is saying. Allow me to continue the argument, though, for just a moment. The scripture is without error. Yes, we got that. It's inerrant because it was breathed out by God. The scripture does not need man's spin on it. And we do hear a spin on the scripture every day from someplace. There's always a spin on it. Well, what he really meant was, what he was really saying was, we call that eisegesis. That's someone putting into the scripture what they want to put into it. I have a warning for you, by the way, for all of you that put what you want to put into the scripture. All of you that tell the story, you want to tell the story the way you want it to be heard by those that are listening to you. You need to tell the story accurately. Here's the reason why you need to tell it accurately. The last book in the Bible is the book of Revelation. But when God speaks about the book of Revelation, he's not just talking about that book, like the 66th book of the Bible. He's talking about the entire writing, the sapate graphes, the whole book from beginning to end. And here's what the Lord says about that. In Revelation 22, verses 18 and 19, he says, I warn everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this book. If anyone adds to them, God will add to him the plagues described in this book. I don't know if you've thought about all the plagues in the book of the Bible. I really don't know if you've thought about that. But he says, when you add to the word of God, when you put your spin on it, when you say, this is what he means, when you need to be careful and make sure that you're accurate in that, because if you're wrong in that, God's going to add some plagues to your life. That's what the scripture says. Now, he also says that if anyone takes away from the words of the book of this prophecy, you know how some people, they won't tell you the whole thing. They just tell you their part of it. Again, putting their spin on it. He says, God will take away his share. The person that takes away from the word of God, God will take that person's share in the tree of life in the holy city, which are described in this book. In other words, he's going to remove you. Now, I don't know how he's going to remove you. I don't profess to know all of that because he didn't tell us that. But he says that in his word. So personal training is important, especially in the word of God. Paul is reminding Timothy how important it is. So here's the second point to be made. The first was continue. The second one is comprehend. We need to comprehend what we're being told. So here, 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 14b, knowing from whom you learned it. You need to know who's telling you what they're telling you about the scripture and if they're indeed accurate or not. Don't just go out and repeat what someone says, the word says. Know for yourself what the word is saying. That's what he's telling us. Timothy's mother and his grandmother discipled him, and in doing so, they taught him the word, and they taught him the word with accuracy. Paul reflects this. The Apostle Paul wrote to Timothy these words in 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 5. He says, I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice. And I know, I am sure it dwells in you as well. Paul is recalling to Timothy's mind who taught him the word of God first. And that is the root of our behavior, is always tied to who taught you something first. When that personal trainer taught you how to lean over, to bend over, stoop down, lift up, or stretch out, and all of those little tricks that they teach you, that's who taught you first. And that trainer knew what they were doing. So you can recall, oh yeah, my trainer taught me that. Oh yeah, my mom taught me that. Oh yeah, my grandmother taught me that. It's the word of God that's important to us. If we're going to build the muscle of faith, we've got to go back to where we got it in the first place. Where did we get our training from? This is important. We need to thank God every day for the trainers of the Word of God, those that have labored in truth and have taught us the truth. Thank God for them every single day of your life, because that is what makes us strong in our faith today. It's the way that we were brought up in it. And I'm not saying that everybody that believes in Jesus Christ need to have been taught the faith from birth, or as they say, cradle to the grave. That's not what I'm talking about. At some point in time, you turned your life over to the Lord. At that point in time, someone began to teach you the word. And that's what I'm talking about here. That's what Paul is talking about. Just so happens that Timothy got taught from a child. So Paul tells Timothy, he says, the point is not so much that you knew who they were, but that you had been taught even as a child. I bring this back full circle now. That's why it's so important we don't allow COVID to destroy relationships of children being in fellowship. It's important that children grow up in the Word of God. It's very important. It shapes their Christian worldview, if I could say it that way. So we have the story that in 2 Timothy 3 and 15, Paul again says, from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. Coming up as a little one and getting that word as a little one, it makes you wise. It's going to help you to make the right choice. And the choice to be made is for Christ in your future. We are having to ask ourselves even today, as it comes to our children, are we providing a conducive atmosphere for learning for our children, for those that we are discipling, whether they're children or adults? Are we as Christians doing the best job of training our children in ways of our God? My middle daughter, Dr. Nicole Howard, writes this in her book, Standing in the Gap. She says, in order to engage and become prepared for academic success, students must be given opportunities to take ownership of their learning. The action of taking ownership reflects the notion of student agency. Student agency is about engaging your students in every aspect of their learning process, including designing their room, as simple as that. If the children are not engaged from the very beginning, as Timothy was here, as Paul is calling to his remembrance, then that muscle of faith will not be sustainable over the period of adulthood. There's urgency to this. The Apostle Paul is really reminding Timothy that we had been taught by his, that he had been taught by his mom and his grandmother. Think for a minute, how do you feel when someone reminds you by saying, I know you remember what your mama told you? Think about that. Hair rises on the back of your neck, because when mom taught it, it was really taught. Yeah. And that's why Paul is recalling Timothy's attention to the fact that he's been taught the word. He's been properly trained. Now, back to Valerie Burton. She says that we should ask ourselves another very important question. This time next year, what would I like to see different in my life? In other words, if I take into consideration all that I've talked about here today about the training in the Word of God and how that training starts and when it starts and how we're nurtured along the way, we should be able to ask ourselves, what is it I want to see different in my life a year from now? Why am I saying that? Because that gives me time to get into the training session, to renew my relationship with the personal trainer. I need to get back in, because I found some areas of my life that I've become weak in. Now I need to get stronger. So how do I do that? See, I think it's critically important that we ask ourselves that. In other words, what's my vision? What's your vision for you? That's the scripture says that without a vision, the people perish. You need a vision for where you're going, no matter how insignificant you think your life is. Your life is important. You need a vision. God wants you to be deliberate about setting goals and moving forward. God's word tells us to write the vision and to make it plain, Habakkuk 3:2. That means we should write it down and make it clear and specific. Don't overwhelm yourself with a lot of, I want to do this and I want to do that. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about set a vision, set a goal. Organize some steps to get to that goal. How will I get there? If you want your children and those around you to become stronger in their faith, what's your plan for that? How do you get that done? This means that we should not only write it down, but we should write it down specifically. Instead, choose something that's very meaningful. Look at a short-range goal. You can have a long-range goal. But look at a short range. How will I change immediately? What steps will I take? So what's our learning outcome? In planning how you will go forward in your Christian walk, you must look back over where you came from. Excuse me. And what you have learned, especially from the trials and sufferings and disappointments. In other words, the mistakes that you made. The things that you've fallen down on, the commitments that you no longer make as a Christian. Look back over. You know, my wife, Beverly, God rest her soul, used to sing this song that had so much meaning in it. You've been so faithful. Let me offer you the words to this song. She would start out singing, as I look back over my life, I can see how your love has guided me. Even though I've done wrong, you never left me alone. But you forgave me and you kept on blessing. This I recall to my mind, therefore I have hope. It's because of your mercies that we are not consumed, because thy compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. You've been, Lord, you've been so faithful. Even though sometimes I didn't do what you wanted me to do, you've been faithful. Lord, you've been so faithful. I can never repay you, Lord, for what you've done for me. How you loosed my shackles and you set me free. How you made a way out of no way, turned my darkness into day. You've been my joy in the time of sorrow, hope for my tomorrow, peace in the time of storm, strength when I'm weak and worn. You've been, Lord, you've been so faithful. And then she always ended that song with a little line that said, even though sometimes I didn't do what you wanted me to do. Friends, we have to go back to the Lord and say, Lord, I know where I got my faith. I know where I came to faith at. I know who helped strengthen me in the truth. Now I'm suffering with this atrophy of faith. My faith is weakened. But when I'm weak, you're strong. You're providing what I need. Just go back to where you got it from. Renew the relationships. Renew your commitment to study the Word of God, to be accurate in His truth. And then receive the blessings of Almighty God. He wants to shower down blessings into your life today. But He wants you to be strong. And as Paul was telling Timothy, there is a journey ahead of you, and there is some disappointment coming. There is some challenges that you have to face, and you're going to need your faith. So it's going to be good for you to remember where you came to faith, how you got that faith. Get back into that personal training. Strengthen up those areas where you're weak, where the muscle is turning to atrophy. You can do better, and God wants better out of us. God bless you, friend. Have a wonderful week this week. Strengthen the muscle of your faith. Blessings to you.
nothing else matters.
Come on.